1,000 years before and after Jesus, a small collection of writings found their way into the sacred scriptures of Jews and Christians. To this day, this small library of ancient writings is accepted by many as the Word of God. But there were hundreds of religious writings considered important at the time that were left out of the Holy Bible. What is contained in these rejected books, and why were they left out?
Some of this forbidden material, a lot of it comes from the Gnostic groups.
Were some writings thought too fanciful?
Where is the story coming from? What kind of a community does the story arise out of? Is this an old traditional Christian community?
Perhaps these excluded or banned books were simply deemed unworthy for inclusion in sacred scripture.
Some of them were decided to be rather suspicious and perhaps of questionable influence. And so there is a collection of books that we would say are literally forbidden.
The story of the Forbidden Bible begins some 150 years after the birth of Jesus. It was an obscure figure in history, a man named Marcion, who became the unlikely catalyst for a Christian version of the Holy Bible. He was a man of great wealth and strong convictions.
Marcion of Pontus was called the Mus Ponticus, the Pontic Rat. He was a church leader who was a very wealthy individual. He owned his own ship. He was involved in the shipping industry. And he not only was very wealthy, but he had some very strict theological points of view. He was a Bible-believing, Bible-thumping Christian who believed everything that he thought was Christian in the Bible. But when he looked at the Jewish Bible, what he saw there startled him and appalled him, because he was very literalistic in his reading. And so he took a look at the Jewish Bible, and he thought he saw a God there who was harsh and vindictive and legalistic. And Marcion said, "That's not the God that I believe in."
Marcion was convinced that the God of the Hebrew Bible was not the God taught by Jesus. Without any church authority, Marcion created his own Christian Bible. Hebrew scripture, what Christians call the Old Testament, was banned in this book. The only writings he considered worthy were Luke's Gospel, with all references to the Old Testament erased, and Paul's letters.
Considering what Marcion did, it's no wonder that one of his opponents said, "Shame on Marcion's eraser." Marcion wanted very badly to be accepted as a great church leader, and one day he met somebody who was very well known, and he came up to the person and he said, "Don't you recognize who I am?" And this other church leader turned to Marcion and said, "Yes, you're the firstborn of Satan."
In spite of his notoriety among second century Christian leaders, Marcion's basic idea took hold. The new Christian religion should have a Bible to call its own. The church fathers of Marcion's day began to create lists, books they believed had to be included in a Christian Bible, and books that should be left out. There was no shortage of material. Some of these individual writings had been circulating separately and randomly within Christian communities, large and small, since the end of the first century. The four Gospels, the Acts of the Apostles, the Epistles of Timothy and Titus, and the letters of the Apostle Paul.
These were personal letters. They were occasional letters that addressed the needs in the various churches. And if Paul had any idea what people would do with his letters in terms of theologizing on the basis of them, he would have been a whole lot more careful when he wrote them.
By the year 150 AD, hundreds of manuscripts were being written by the emerging Christian leaders and theologians throughout the Roman Empire and beyond. But another century would pass without an officially recognized Bible. Then, on October 28th, 312, everything changed. A man named Constantine had a vision of a cross in the sky as he prepared to do battle for the city of Rome. Legend has it that Jesus spoke to him in a vision saying, "In my name, conquer." The following day, he won the battle, defeated the superior force of Maxentius, his rival, and became the sole emperor of Rome. It was the vision of this cross and the victory that followed that fueled Constantine's newfound interest in the Christian faith. The pagan civilization that had overseen the crucifixion of Jesus was about to adopt the faith it once tried to destroy.
Constantine as emperor had a number of things he was dealing with. He was a shrewd politician, a statesman, a diplomat, a warrior, but he realized that he needed to have some order and some unity in the empire, and that order and unity could come through at least having some religion or some religious purpose that could bring all people together, because religion could be something that could unite the empire.
The Near East at the time of Constantine was a massive conglomeration of different perspectives, different peoples, different races, different religions. It really was a very mixed situation. There were differing Jewish groups. There was a diversity of Christian groups. There was all kinds of dialogue going on.
You have the little Christian church on one end of the corner. You have the pagan worship on the other end of the corner. People go where they want to go, but at the same time, they have questions about what door you're walking into. And then you have the contentions within each of these communities about what's the proper way to worship.
There were in the early church a wide variety of ways of being Christian. One could be a Jewish Christian, one could be a Gentile Christian, one could be more Gnostic in one's point of view, one could be very mystical, one could be rather legalistic.
Even so, a battle was raging in the early churches. Arius, a monastic from the city of Alexandria, believed that Jesus was the highest created being, but he was not God. In vehement opposition to this opinion was Athanasius, bishop of the Alexandrian church. It was his passionate belief that Jesus was both man and God. These two men fought fiercely over this one question: was the Savior human, or was he divine? For the sake of his Roman Empire, Constantine needed to solve this bitter dispute once and for all. And thus, 300 years after the Romans executed Jesus, Constantine summoned all the Christian bishops in order to unify the church. The meeting was to take place in his summer palace in the seaside resort of Nicaea in what is today modern Turkey.
When he brought all the bishops together at Nicaea, what was on his mind was that they all would agree on the question, the divinity and the humanity of Jesus. How was that to be explained? And the important thing for him was one explanation. So there was a huge pressure on them to agree on something. They had to walk out in agreement.
The agreement these bishops would hammer out eventually became known as the Nicene Creed. It declared that Jesus was both man and God. Athanasius, the bishop from Alexandria, had won the day.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven. All of these concepts are in the creed, but they're biblical concepts. So the point then is, let's put together a work, a volume, a book, a codex. Let us now decide what will go into it, into the canon, that can be acceptable to the entire church. Not one piece here, one piece there, to the entire church.
One man who was present at the Council of Nicaea was Eusebius, Bishop of Caesarea in Palestine. Eusebius was fascinated by Christian antiquities, and he had immersed himself in the manuscripts housed in two nearby Christian libraries, one in Caesarea, another in Jerusalem. The same year the Council of Nicaea met, Eusebius published his church history. In it was a list of 18 books he believed should make up a Christian canon.
And what was interesting about that is that he mentions three different types of books that people were reading. There were the accepted ones, such as the four Gospels, the Acts of the Apostles, Paul's letters. These were all accepted.
Next in order, the extant former Epistle of John, and likewise the Epistle of Peter, must be recognized. After these must be put, if it really seems right, the Apocalypse of John, concerning which we shall give the different opinions at the proper time.
Eusebius was only too aware that many of his contemporaries thought John's apocalypse bordered on the heretical, that its violent imagery seemed at war with the Savior's message of peace.
Then a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and threw it into the sea, saying, "With such violence, Babylon, the great city, will be thrown down and will be found no more."
Do you really want to have a book like that in the canon? With all the fire and brimstone and the hatred and the anger and the animosity that is found there? Do you really want all that damnation in the Bible?
But he mentions other ones that he thinks are disputed, including ones that we now have in, for example, second and third letter of John, second letter of Peter, letter of James, letter of Jude. He calls them disputed. And he mentions other ones that are not in at the moment. And then there's the heretical ones that are not in anyone's list.
Books that were considered forbidden were books that aren't really sanctioned. In other words, you have things like The Shepherd of Hermas that are stories that are being told about Jesus, but they don't have any veracity. They may be part of a certain community's canon, but they're not part of the total canon. In other words, they're not things that people in other parts of the Christian world would recognize.
6 years after the Council of Nicaea, Emperor Constantine sent a letter to Bishop Eusebius, giving him the job of creating an official Christian Bible.
"I have thought it expedient to instruct your prudence to order 50 copies of the sacred scriptures to be written on prepared parchment in a legible manner and in a convenient portable form by professional transcribers thoroughly practiced in their art."
Eusebius simply took the list from the church history he had written, 18 books he believed worthy of inclusion, and assembled these into Constantine's Bible. In stark contrast to Marcion's version of a Christian Bible, this volume combined the Hebrew scriptures with a set of Christian manuscripts, an Old and a New Testament.
50 beautiful Bibles done on vellum and parchment for the churches of Constantinople. There's no indication that Constantine saw a problem with disputed books or different canons or different lists. That's not there at all. What he seemed to be concerned with is Constantinople, his new capital, called after himself, of course, was going to have lots of new churches. He wanted a beautiful Bible enshrined in each of those churches.
But this Bible, commissioned by the Roman Emperor, was lost to time. And with it, the precise list of books it contained.
There are possibilities. For example, we have two 4th century codices, books of the Bible, the entire Bible. One is called the Codex Vaticanus because it's in the Vatican. The other is the Codex Sinaiticus, which is in the British Library. It was found at Mount Sinai in St. Catherine's Monastery. And we can't be sure of the contents because there's missing pages.
If either of these ancient fragmentary documents are indeed copies of Constantine's Bible, it appears their contents differ from Eusebius's list. There are at least two disputed books included in Codex Sinaiticus: The Shepherd of Hermas, a popular book among early Christians, and the Epistle of Barnabas. Yet even after Constantine's beautifully rendered Bibles were sent to the churches in Constantinople, it would be another 40 years before a final list of 27 New Testament books would be officially canonized by the church.
What we have to understand is that nobody wrote the New Testament. The New Testament is an assembled library, a small library of documents. They had to make a major discussion of how are we going to have the Hebrew scriptures in their Greek rendition in our Bible. Will the Bible start with Matthew? Will the Bible start with Matthew? Or will the Bible start with Genesis?
Many highly popular writings were excluded, some of which were even more popular than the books that were accepted.
What is straight thinking and proper thinking? And that discussion is not just theological, it's social, it's political, and the answer to those questions is determined by a vote. What are the right books to read, and what books should not pass before the eyes of the faithful? What books should be forbidden for their reading?
In biblical times, hundreds of scrolls and manuscripts circulated throughout the Holy Land, tales that appeared to shed more light on many well-known biblical figures. Most were not included in the Hebrew or Christian Bibles. A little-known ancient text called The Life of Adam and Eve is one such writing, a forbidden book that tells a more detailed story of creation than the familiar tale found in the Old Testament.
Eve said to Adam, "My Lord, would that I might die. Perhaps then the Lord God would bring you back into paradise. For it was because of me that the Lord God grew angry with you."
There are jealous angels and a far more devious and persistent serpent.
The life of Adam and Eve begins with sort of the backstory of what you get in the Genesis 3 account. In the Genesis 3 account, you have the snake, the wisest of all creatures, who tempts the woman with a couple of sort of truths into taking a bite of the fruit. She also gives the fruit to her husband, and as soon as they consume the fruit, they recognize that they are naked. And they're ashamed, they avoid God.
One important motivation for writing another version was to fill in the gaps in the Genesis story, and I believe to provide a larger context for it, to explain why it was that something so odd as a serpent would be tempting a woman to eat forbidden fruit.
But if the life of Adam and Eve gave an ancient audience more information about Eve's temptation and fall from grace, why was it left out of the Bible?
The life of Adam and Eve was no doubt excluded because it would have had to have come in the first part of the Bible. The Christian Bible tells a story. Not only the texts that are chosen to go in it, but the order of the text. It begins with Genesis, or the beginning, and it ends with Revelation, a tale of the end. Therefore, if you were going to include something like the life of Adam and Eve in the Christian Bible, you would need to include it in the beginning of the text, near Genesis. Since it's clearly a retelling of Genesis, there was no place for it in that canon.
But not an exact retelling. Some scholars believe the life of Adam and Eve was written in the first century, as much as 1,000 years after the first known written manuscript of Genesis. There is another theory that it was written at a later time, in the 3rd or 4th century, at the time the Christian Bible was taking form.
What the reasons for its not attaining that status might be, we don't know. It could be, this is just guessing, that people knew it was written at a later time. The teachings of the book you would think would be compatible with Jewish and Christian teachings, but we don't have any ancient discussion about why it may have been thought not on the same level with, say, Genesis.
While its exclusion may be a mystery, we do know the book was popular in its day. The anonymous writer gave his ancient audience a chance to see these temptations from Eve's point of view. It is a surprising tale of deceit and betrayal, far different from the version found in Genesis. In The Life of Adam and Eve, Eve seems to be an innocent victim.
We find out that Eve was alone. Adam was nowhere near her. They both had separate halves of the garden. We also find out that the guardian angels who are supposed to protect Adam and Eve are gone. So Eve is sitting there alone when all of a sudden she sees not only the serpent, but the devil disguised as an angel. And this devil as an angel convinces her to take from the tree that she is not supposed to eat from. And at first she says, no, I really shouldn't do that. It'll make God angry. And he says, after you're done, you won't need to worry about God, in effect.
When Satan's ruse is revealed, Eve's innocent trust turns to terror. She realizes that Adam will share her hellish punishment, expulsion from paradise, and a life of wandering in an unforgiving wasteland.
Adam and Eve, of course, want to get back into the garden. And so Adam devises a means by which they are tested, and they stand in rivers. They stand in separate rivers.
"Do you wish to kill me that I might die?"
Adam responded, "Don't say such things, Eve, lest the Lord God bring upon us some other curse. How could it be that I should raise my hand against my own flesh?"
Adam decides to stand in the River Jordan for 40 days and suggests to Eve that since she's weaker, she should only stand in the Tigris for 34 days. However, while she's in the Tigris, the devil comes disguised as an angel after 18 days and convinces her to leave the river.
The Lord God has heard your lamenting and accepted your penitence. Now, therefore, come out of the water and I will lead you to the place where your food is prepared.
She walks over to Adam with this wonderful news. We've been rescued from the rivers. And Adam looks at her and sees not an angel standing beside her, but the devil. And he says, Eve, how could you have done this again?
When Adam was created in God's image, the angels were ordered to bow to Adam or worship Adam. And Satan refused to do this. He said he should not bow to someone who was created after he was, and who was inferior to him.
In defiance, Satan and his gang of rebel angels build a rival throne that literally places them above God. Outraged, God expels them from heaven and banishes them into the depths of the earth. This tale of Satan's jealousy and revenge is not found in the Holy Bible, yet it is among the stories told in the Quran, sacred scripture for Muslims, written 800 years later.
The Quran tells us that God creates human beings, Adam, out of clay, and that God creates these mysterious beings, jinn, out of what the Quran says is smokeless fire, fire without smoke. God calls Adam the greatest of his God's creations, and tells the angels to bow down before this creation. And one of them refuses. In the text of the Quran, Satan, Iblis, refuses to bow down. We're not sure what manner of being Satan is, so there's contention there among Muslims. You know, is this an angel that disobeys? Because how can the angels disobey God?
For Christians and Jews, the creation story in Genesis leaves a lingering question. If Adam and Eve had two sons and no daughters, if no other humans existed, who gave birth to humanity? One of the Holy Bible's more puzzling omissions is found in the book of Genesis, in the story of Adam and Eve's son, Cain. He murders his brother, Abel, is cursed by God, and becomes a fugitive. Then, suddenly, we learn that Cain has a wife who is pregnant.
And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden. And Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch.
Anyone who's ever taught Sunday school is familiar with the problem that you talk about Cain getting married, and suddenly a million hands go up. Wait a minute, where did the wife come from? We know about Adam and Eve, of course, but what about their children, their sons, who were the wives of the first males? I think that the Bible story is disturbing on many levels, but some people find it most disturbing in the way that it doesn't make literal sense, that Cain obviously can't marry somebody who doesn't exist, and they can't get to the deeper levels until they find some kind of peace with the narrative level, with the story of what happened. And so for many, until we can figure out who Cain's wife was, we can't discuss the deeper issues.
Some 150 years before the birth of Jesus, an unknown author sought to clarify the telling of creation as written in the book of Genesis. It was a time in history when many Jews were being tempted by other faiths. The author wanted to maintain the purity of their beliefs to ensure strict observance of all Jewish law. His book, called Jubilees, offers intimate details of the lives and struggles of the first human beings. It begins with Moses. He is visited by an angel who reveals a secret behind-the-scenes version of Jewish history, from the very beginning of creation to the parting of the Red Sea.
I would suggest that the Book of Jubilees is what we would today call a fundamentalist book. Why? The Book of Jubilees tries to answer unanswered questions, to cross every T and dot every I of the stories in Genesis. They bleep over the parts that they don't think are particularly important, and they dwell on the issues that they want answered. He wants to take it too literally, and therefore gets boxed into a corner of having to explain every detail. And it comes out creating more problems than it actually solves.
Among the more disturbing revelations offered in Jubilees is a rather chilling answer to the mysterious and sudden appearance of a wife for Cain. Jubilees tells us that Adam and Eve have 9 sons and daughters, not just the 3 sons, Cain, Abel, and Seth, mentioned in Genesis. Jubilees also tells of Cain's younger sister, Awan, who becomes his wife.
And Cain took Awan, his sister, to be his wife, and she bare him Enoch at the close of the 4th Jubilee.
There is in the Bible a fairly powerful prohibition against incest, and clearly the idea that Cain married his sister would be very difficult for people. And it just shows how hard it was for people to accept that a new woman would come out of nowhere.
It's interesting to have folks in the 21st century reading Jubilees. The same people who like reality TV, the same people who will go to a movie such as Aliens, who seem to really sort of enjoy gore, violence, sex. Those sorts of folks just would seem to love Jubilees.
If the Bible is read as literal history, a story of the first humans that included incest would have been taboo and thus not acceptable for inclusion in the Holy Bible. Even so, why would this ancient author solve the problem of Cain's wife by having him marry his own sister?
This is a culture that is a little bit nervous about foreign women. And one of the ways to get over your nervousness about foreign women is to marry women who aren't that foreign. The problem is, you marry women who aren't that foreign, they tend to be related.
It was important to the writer that God had chosen a pure race, and that he had done this from the earliest times, and that this race had to remain pure. These would be the Jewish people in his own time, who were to refrain from intermarrying with their neighbors, or really to have any contact with their neighbors, to maintain purity.
I quite frankly find the way Jubilees recasts the Genesis stories so objectionable. I quite frankly think it was a laudable decision on the part of Judaism and Christianity to reject this book. They were familiar with it, they clearly read it, they knew it, and quite reasonably and in an informed way said, no, this is not part of the tradition. Who needs Jubilees?
Among those who studied the Book of Jubilees was a Jewish sect known as the Essenes. In 1947, a wandering shepherd stumbled upon their writings, tucked away in several caves overlooking the Dead Sea. This collection, lost for almost 2,000 years, became known worldwide as the Dead Sea Scrolls. Jubilees was among the documents that were found.
We have reason to think that they had run afoul of the authorities, particularly the high priest in Jerusalem, and that this group felt it had to go into a kind of exile. Maybe it was self-imposed, we don't know the details about it. But they used the Book of Jubilees. They may have been a persecuted group. They thought of themselves that way. But apparently these texts spoke to them.
Jubilees was a book that was never considered for canonization by mainstream Christian leaders. But there is a Bible that does include it. Somehow, the Book of Jubilees found its way down the Nile and into the heart of Africa to Ethiopia and the Old Testament of the Ethiopian Christian Bible.
One of the things that we need to remember is the function of the Nile in the river and how art and economy and text, as it were, would make that way south. And we also need to remember that Jewish communities of some antiquity would likewise follow trade and art patterns. And so the Jewish community became so heavily persecuted in the area around Jerusalem that there would be migrations, and some of those migrations probably went as far south as Ethiopia. And that would be how it would get there.
In a sense, perhaps the Ethiopian Orthodox Church is the best of what Christianity could have done in marrying the Jewish and the Christian traditions together. It's not a community that had a lot of outside interference, in a sense. So they're able to develop their own canon. They're able to do some things without outside interference from other theologians or people who want to change their way of thinking.
Because the literature of Ethiopia reflects an early stage of Christian literature, or what was read by Christians, and that these works were brought into Ethiopia. The book was preserved there as a kind of authoritative dealing with the stories of Genesis.
Jubilees is not the only ancient text that gives a different story of creation. There is a forbidden book, lost for centuries, that includes fallen angels, bloodthirsty giants, and a warning to all humanity. It is an ancient writing filled with divine secrets, dreams, and visions. A tour of heaven and hell, guided by the angel Uriel. The Book of Enoch is named for the man who the Holy Bible says walked with God.
Enoch walked with God after the birth of Methuselah 300 years, and had other sons and daughters. Thus all the days of Enoch were 365 years. Enoch walked with God, then he was no more because God took him.
The Book of Enoch is named for a man who's mentioned in one sentence in the book of Genesis. We only know one sentence worth of information about him. And yet, somebody stopped, paused on that name, and thought, Enoch. If he was taken up into heaven, what might he have seen?
It is a daunting manuscript. 5 volumes containing 108 chapters. For many ancient Christians, the Book of Enoch was essential. Yet it was banned from the Christian Bible.
We don't know why this literature was ultimately excluded from the canon. Perhaps it's because of its description of the fall of the rebel angels and their mating with mortals. Perhaps its understanding of the end of time fell out of favor with Jews and Christians.
The Book of Enoch begins with a warning to all humanity that a divine judgment has been rendered and a sentence will be imposed. God tells Enoch that all life on earth will be destroyed in a violent flood, and, as with the story in Genesis, God blames this evil on the sons of God, angels who lusted after the daughters of men.
These angels are sometimes referred to as watchers. They keep constant watch, and they decide one day, about 200 of them, that they're going to descend to the earth. They would like to very much make contact with these mortal women.
The Book of Enoch may have been an attempt to expand on the mysterious giants, the sons of God, and the daughters of the earth, spoken of in Genesis.
Anytime you read the Book of Genesis, there are all kinds of unanswered questions. Suddenly, there is this quick few verses at the beginning of the flood story about giants in a land that come from the sons of God mixing with the daughters of the earth. And you stop and think, wait a minute, what's this all about? It's like it went by too fast. And you want to grab it and say, wait a minute, what was this?
The Book of Enoch offers a disturbing vision of the fall of the angels who lust after earthly women.
And they began to go into them and to defile themselves with them. And they taught them charms and enchantments. And they became pregnant and they bare great giants whose height was 3,000 ells. And when men could no longer sustain them, the giants turned against them and devoured mankind.
That these angels have crossed over this boundary that they shouldn't have. They were spiritual beings and they were to remain as such. When they decided to descend upon earth, this unleashed upon the earth all sorts of problems. Not only these giants who are bloodthirsty and violent, but also these angels went on to teach humankind a variety of forbidden crafts. They also taught human beings how to make weapons of war.
Now, the good angels, the ones not tempted by these beautiful women, go to God and say, you know, there's a lot of bloodshed caused by these bad angels. At which point God says, we need to bind Azazel, the sort of lead fallen angel, to bind him and to then cast him into a pit. We might think of this as, how do we take care of nuclear waste in the 21st century? You take it out to a part of the world where no one lives, and you bury it as deep as you can. For this community, the angel was like that sort of nuclear waste. dangerous, volatile.
After the rebel angels are cast into the depths of the earth, Enoch has a dream vision. The lead angel, Azazel, begs Enoch to plead their case before God, to petition the Almighty to release them from the depths of the earth. The request for clemency is denied.
This version of the fall of the angels was very popular in its day and maintained popularity for centuries to come. When we look at Dante's work on the Inferno, it's largely out of the material in Enoch. When we look at various snips of the New Testament, Enoch seems to be in play. In Corinthians, when Paul talks about women covering their hair so the angels won't be seduced and tempted, it goes back to the fallen angels tradition.
Another episode tells of Uriel, a powerful angel in charge of the stars, who becomes Enoch's guide through the heavenly realms.
Uriel's name, in fact, means God is my light. And whenever he is described, frequently in relation to God, he is situated to the east of God's throne. This is very interesting. Of course, the sun rises to the east. So this gets us thinking, Uriel, a figure associated with light, perhaps associated in some way with the sun, or the stars, or the idea of these heavenly bodies making their rotations daily.
And all these Uriel, the holy angel, who is the leader of them all, showed to me, and their positions, and I wrote down their positions as he showed them to me.
And so something is going on here with the stars. It may well be going back to the role of astrology and the study of stars in the Persian Empire that is now giving rise to this new awareness that constellations aren't just constellations of stars, they're constellations of power. And through this tour of heaven, Enoch gets the information, and he knows where the powers are, and to know where the powers are means that you have access to the power.
With its lush descriptions of heavenly powers and the horrors that await evildoers, even angels, Enoch was one of the most popular books among the early Christians.
We know that some early Christians considered the writings of Enoch to be authoritative, to contain actual revelation from God. So, because some people thought that, some influential people thought that, the book was used as you would use other books of the Bible.
After all, Revelation appears in the New Testament. But Enoch, for reasons that I think are fairly clear, was just considered a little too strange, a little too suspicious, a little too creative, perhaps, for the tradition. Having said that, there's no doubt that it was widely read and very popular.
Yet the Book of Enoch was denied a home in the official Christian canon. This imaginative tale fell into obscurity until the late 18th century, when a Scottish explorer named James Bruce came upon this mysterious text in Aksum, a city in the Ethiopian highlands.
Travelers to Ethiopia found manuscripts of these books and brought them back to Europe. This caused quite a sensation. I'm aware of scholarly reaction to them. People were excited about having these texts about only through allusion before this time, or a brief quotation. Whether this raised any questions in people's minds, canonical questions, should we put these books in the Bible? I'm not aware of really intense discussions of that sort.
Until the mid-20th century, the Book of Enoch was assumed to be of interest only to the very early Christians. We now know that Enoch was sacred to Ethiopian Christians all along.
Part of the reason why this probably became part of their canon is because of the mythic story of the foundation of the Ethiopian monarchy. You have Sheba who goes to see King Solomon, and the story goes that not only does she bring gifts, she brings him a little bit of something back home.
She's pregnant with Solomon's son. That son is Menelik. Menelik is the first dynastic king of Ethiopia. He actually goes back and retrieves the Ark of the Covenant from Solomon because Solomon is not taking care of the kingdom properly. And the Ark rests reportedly in Aksum in Ethiopia. So when Christianity comes later in about the 4th century to Ethiopia, there's already a story there. There's already a connection to the Old Testament story. So the Book of Enoch and all these other types of books that are included within the Ethiopian canon become part and parcel of putting together this Old Testament story, this Old Testament link, with a very new Christianity that enters into the Ethiopian. They don't give up the old. They put it all together with the new and blend it together.
Large portions of the Book of Enoch also were found among the Essene literature, hidden in the caves of Qumran, as part of the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Enochic literature was very popular with the inhabitants at Qumran, at least for a while, probably at the beginning of this group's existence at the site. And how do we know it was so popular? At least 11 manuscripts of this text have been discovered. And that's quite a number, especially when we think in terms of what it cost to produce a manuscript in antiquity, in terms of not only the material required, but also the labor.
And so sometimes what people are reading and what the leadership in the church actually wants you to understand are two very different things.
Today, ancient writings not included in the Bible are being re-examined by 21st century eyes. Next, disturbing stories of Jesus as a child.
One of Jesus' playmates is killed, presumably by Jesus pushing him off a roof.
By the second century, the Jesus movement was coming of age. Still, without formal leadership or an officially designated text, early Christians were hungry for any information about their Savior. Books that were to become the Gospels of Luke and Matthew offered some information about the birth of Jesus, but all four Gospels were virtually silent on his early years. But a book not included in the Bible does deal with the childhood of Jesus.
I, Thomas the Israelite, am reporting to you, all my non-Jewish brothers and sisters, to make known the extraordinary childhood deeds of our Lord Jesus Christ, what he did after his birth in my region. This is how it all started.
It describes Jesus as a boy. He's anywhere between 5 years of age and 12 years of age. He performs all sorts of unusual feats. He gets into quite a bit of trouble.
The infancy gospel of Thomas was never a candidate for inclusion in the New Testament because it was written late enough in the second century to be too late for any genuine consideration as a gospel for the New Testament. But it was a very popular book because of its attempt to satisfy the curiosity about the childhood of Jesus.
The early fathers of the church obviously were aware of these stories. Today we would call them little extra romance story novelettes, what years ago were called dime store novels. They were aware of them because their own parishioners, their faithful, would bring them up.
The earliest existing copy of the Infancy Gospel of Thomas is a document from the 6th century. But at least one clue suggests his book was in circulation as early as 185 A.D. At that time, a prominent bishop said that the stories then circulating about Jesus as a boy were spurious and apocryphal. He may have been referring to the Infancy Gospel of Thomas. The book, written by an unknown author, begins with several disturbing miracle stories.
One miracle has him allegedly by the River Jordan, because there weren't many rivers for him to be at in that part of the world, where he was making little sparrows out of clay, and apparently the authorities reported to his father Joseph that he was doing work on the Sabbath, which was forbidden by Jewish law. Joseph reprimanded Jesus for doing so, and Jesus was upset. He clapped his hands and he told the sparrows to fly away and to say, remember this of me.
There is a story in the Infancy Gospel of Thomas in which one of Jesus' playmates is killed, presumably by Jesus pushing him off a roof. And this little boy's parents, of course, are very upset and very angry at Jesus.
Well, Jesus at this point has acquired something of a reputation for himself in the village. And so people come around and they say, now, why did you push him off, Jesus? You know, how could you have done such a thing? And Jesus says, I didn't push him off. I had nothing to do with his death. And in fact, to provide some evidence of his innocence, Jesus raises his playmate from the dead, brings him back to life, and says, Zenon, tell them, did I push you down? And Zenon says, no, Lord, you didn't have anything to do with my death.
According to the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, Jesus, age 5, was not only a powerful, strong-willed child who was sometimes willing to heal people, he also had a dark and even malevolent side to his character.
They had the young boy Jesus blinding a customer of his father in the carpenter shop for criticizing his father's work in the carpentry shop. I don't think people were looking necessarily for historical accuracy.
Disturbing as these stories may have been, like a 21st century audience, early Christians wanted to know more.
The Gospel of Thomas is a story in 3 acts. Everyone knows the first one, what I call the bye-bye birdie, where Jesus makes the birds out of clay and they fly away, and wow, isn't that great? Jesus at 5 is the first act, and at 5 he is a divine brat. He is like Dennis the Menace as God. He's awful. He uses his wisdom to put down his teacher. He uses his power to knock down his friends. He's rather nasty. He's evil. The second act is Jesus at 8. By the time he gets to 8, everything is beginning to change.
His father, Joseph, who's a carpenter, is trying to build something, and he needs 2 boards of the same length, and he's cut one too short, and he's very upset. And Jesus says, that's all right, Father. Lay the board side by side. Jesus takes the shorter board and stretches it to be just as long as the other board.
He helps his mother by bringing home water in his cloak. He helps his father by making the boards extend miraculously to fit. He heals his brother James from a viper bit. He plants 1 measure of grain. It comes up 100-fold, and he gives it to the poor. He's finally got it. The function of great power and great wisdom is to do good. And then the final act is Jesus at 12, and that simply rejoins Luke.
Although stories from the Infancy Gospel of Thomas are not part of the Christian canon, they are found in Islam's holy book, the Quran.
These stories, even though they weren't officially recognized by the church in the official version of the Bible, they were still being used. So we know that, for example, Christians in Arabia were reading the Infancy Gospel of Thomas. Now, the Muslim understanding is that, of course, that story is there because it is, in fact, true and correct. You know, Muslims see the Quran as the final, the true revelation, and think that the Bible, think that the New Testament has been changed around from its original form.
Stories of a strong-willed and even malevolent young Jesus may have been too disturbing for inclusion in the Holy Bible. But perhaps a lesson was lost in the process. For there may be hope for ordinary folk when even the Son of God gets to grow over time.
So the story, the whole story, the entire narrative, is Jesus growing up to use his great power and great wisdom only for good and be ready for the Jesus that we get in the New Testament. I find that a marvelous book because lots of adults never learn how to use their power and their wisdom for good. Sometimes even great nations don't learn how to use their power and their wisdom for good.
The Christian Bible tells us that a young Jewish virgin named Mary was chosen by God to give birth to the Savior of the world, and that her son's conception would be divine, not mortal, a virgin birth. The Bible gives little detail on Mary's life before or after Jesus is born. But more than a century before the New Testament was canonized, a manuscript bearing the unlikely name, the Protoevangelion of James, was written. This book purports to offer those details of Mary's life missing from the gospel stories.
Of course, the story really is about Mary, And it is often viewed as the first document that focuses attention on Mary, which becomes, in the tradition of the church then, a deep interest in Mary and her personhood and her status.
Why would this popular book have been excluded from the New Testament?
Hard to find a position to put this actually in the New Testament. It would have to be the first thing in the New Testament. And that might make Mary almost more important than Jesus. It would take you a long time to get to Jesus. And so I imagine if anyone really thought about it particularly and said, why not? That might have been the reason. You want to get to Jesus a little faster.
The Protovangelion begins with Mary's middle-aged parents, Joachim and his barren wife, Anna. For years, they prayed desperately for a miracle, asking God to grant them a child. It is when Anna finally gives up that prayer is answered.
And behold, an angel of the Lord appeared, saying unto her, Anna, Anna, the Lord hath hearkened unto thy prayer, and thou shalt conceive and bear, and thy seed shall be spoken of in the whole world. And Anna said to her husband, Now I know the Lord has blessed me very greatly, for behold, she who is barren has conceived.
Some early theologians believed Mary's own conception was miraculous, for Mary's mother Anna was said to be barren. According to their point of view, this proves that Mary herself was born without the stain of original sin. Original sin was a blemish borne by all humanity, reaching back in time to Adam and Eve's fall from grace in the Garden of Eden. While it is commonly accepted that Jesus was conceived and born without original sin, it was his mother Mary, and not Jesus himself, who became known to Catholics worldwide as the Immaculate Conception. By the 4th century, the Roman Catholic Church further expanded this idea, saying Mary remained a virgin throughout her life. Yet, the Bible also reports the existence of Mary's 4 other sons and a number of unnamed daughters. And thus, for some Christian believers, the question of Mary's perpetual virginity became a problem.
There was a problem in accepting the perpetual virginity of Mary, because in the text of Mark especially, and also in Matthew, who follows Mark rather closely, the brothers and sisters of Jesus are mentioned. The idea of the perpetual virginity of Mary is the idea that Mary, as far as the church is concerned, both East and West, was a pure vessel chosen by God to reveal himself through the Holy Spirit in human flesh. The Eastern Church calls her Theotokos, which means the God-bearer. God-bearer meaning that she bore God in the flesh in her womb. It was a pure vessel.
This would prove to be such an important idea that the Protovangelion's author may have attributed his book to one of the most highly respected early Christian leaders, James, a man who was stoned to death almost 100 years before the book was written.
The Protovangelion of James assumes that the author of this document is the man we know from the early church as James the Just, who was the leader of the Jerusalem church after Peter. This James was a brother or half-brother or cousin of Jesus, depending on your theological perspective.
It was absolutely acceptable in ancient writing, ancient Jewish writings and ancient Christian writings, to attribute a work to a renowned ancient prophet or apostle.
The Protovangelion not only makes a strong case for Mary's own immaculate conception and birth, it also reinforces the idea of Mary's virginal conception of Jesus.
Mary becomes pregnant, and Joseph is scandalized, and of course, it's the virginal conception of Jesus that we know of from the canonical Gospels. In this story, there is a woman whose name happens to be Salome who has to check things out. So, pardon me, but she actually sticks her finger in Mary to make sure she really is a virgin. And so that's established, and Joseph is relieved, and Jesus is born.
In this very graphic description, the Protovangelion of James solves one of the most disputed events in the Christian canon. the virgin birth of Jesus. But what about Mary's celibacy after the birth of Jesus? The New Testament speaks of the Savior's brothers and sisters.
Is not this the carpenter's son, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joses, and Jude, and Simon, and are not his sisters here?
So that created a problem for some Christians who believed that Mary was a perpetual virgin. Therefore, how did they handle it in the hidden book called the Proto-Gospel?
They do a search among the widowers in the area to find a holy, pure man who would marry this young woman, and that's how Joseph is found in the story. And so they marry, and he is a widower. He has children in the story by his first marriage. And then, of course, the story becomes a little more traditional.
By telling us that the brothers and sisters of Jesus mentioned in the Bible belong to Joseph and not Mary, the Proto-Evangelium opened the way for later church leaders to assert Mary's perpetual virginity.
It's through the fact that Joseph had, in the Proto-Gospel, other sons. And it was probably James the Less, as we call him. That's one explanation of how you handle this perpetual virginity of Mary with the children who are mentioned, both sisters and brothers of Jesus.
There is no trace of this apocryphal story to be found anywhere in the Christian canon. Yet, it is a tale that circulated throughout the Near East for centuries and would have been known to Arab Christians in the time and place where the Holy Book of Islam was written. The Quran tells of Joseph and Mary's marriage, of Joseph's children by a former wife, and the virgin birth of Jesus.
There are lots of women who are mentioned, so-and-so's wife, so-and-so's daughter, the queen of such and such a place. But Mary's the only one that's mentioned by name. So she has a very important role in the Quran and for Muslims. The story of the Annunciation in the Gospel of Luke is almost exactly paralleled in the 19th chapter of the Quran.
And the Spirit said, I am only a messenger from your Lord sent to bestow a good son on you. How can I have a son, she said, when no man has touched me, nor am I sinful? He said, thus it will be. Your Lord said, it is easy for me, and that we shall make him a sign for men and a blessing from us. This is a thing already decreed.
The fact that Mary is mentioned more by name in the Quran than the Bible, I don't think most Christians are aware of that. The fact that Muslims believe that Jesus was born of Mary, who's a virgin, that the virgin birth of Jesus is an article of faith for Muslims, and a similarity with Christianity.
And so, even as this intriguing text was beginning to gain acceptance with second century Christians, it was stories of Jesus, not his mother, that ultimately were chosen for inclusion in the Christian Bible.
Scholars of the Bible and of the ancient world hope to have, during their lifetime, some kind of a discovery tax. They hope that there might be some new collection of materials that they might be able to look at.
Does ancient wisdom still lie hidden in the sands of the Middle East, waiting to be discovered?
In 1945, the story goes, an Arab peasant was traveling through the desert of Egypt, and he tripped over these large jugs in which were codices, books, these 13 codices that tell these stories of Jesus, these stories of the early Christians that are very different from most of what's preserved in our Bibles. And this story is actually quite engaging because the peasant was apparently involved in a blood feud. His father had been murdered, and he was chasing his father's murderer during the time in which he came across the codices. He then subsequently brought the codices home. He gave them to his mother. She threw them in the straw pile. Some of them were burned for heating, because what is more important when you're living at the edge of subsistence like that? Heat, or what may be absolutely priceless treasures from antiquity? Probably heat. And then the books get into the hands first of a priest and then of a scholar, because he realizes that as he's being chased for having now murdered his father's murderer,
that people might very well be coming around to his house, and the books might be seen as contraband, and so they come into the hands of a priest, and then into the hands of a scholar, and then ultimately into the hands of American and European scholars who begin to translate them and publish them.
So the discovery of the Nag Hammadi Library is a dream that has come true for people. And as the early scholars glanced at the contents of these books, they were taken in particular by some titles like The Gospel According to Thomas, The Gospel According to Philip, The Gospel of the Egyptians, The Gospel of Truth. These were new gospels, besides the New Testament gospels, new Christian interpretations of Jesus that they could look at, and so they gravitated quickly toward these texts.
These were texts that not only were forbidden by leaders of the early church, they were never even considered for inclusion in the sacred canon. They were books written by a little-known, 2,000-year-old Christian sect who thrived for a time throughout the Roman Empire. They were called Gnostics. The church fathers said they were heretics.
The majority decides what is orthodox and what is heretical. The majority is orthodox, the minority is heretical. The majority goes to heaven, the minority goes to hell for their heresy.
The name Gnostic comes from the Greek word gnosis, which means knowledge.
Gnostics believed in the basic structure of the Christian faith in terms of Jesus Christ, but had a very different interpretation than what we would call the orthodox view of Christianity.
The creation stories of Genesis, embraced by church leaders, were rejected by the Gnostics. For them, the physical world was a cosmic mistake, created by an evil, lesser god.
The Gnostics viewed this world as evil, and even the creator of this world as evil. So ultimately, Christian Gnostics identified the God of what we call the Old Testament as an evil God.
The Gnostics also held that salvation would come by means of an inner knowledge, not of the evil creator God, but of the transcendent God, the realm of light and truth.
Interestingly, we have some materials from Gnostics indicating that they could be just as evangelical as the next person. We have some sermons where Gnostics would go around and say, "Wake up, brother and sister. Wake up that God within. Wake up that light that is within. You're sleeping, you are ignorant, and it's time to wake up."
Perhaps it was their revolutionary ideas. Perhaps it was the growing strength of their movement. Whatever the reason, the writings of the Gnostics were among the books that were forbidden by the early church. One of the most intriguing is a text called The Gospel of Mary. It presents an entirely different Mary Magdalene, not the woman commonly thought of as a prostitute.
In the Gospel of Luke, when Luke introduces Mary Magdalene as a disciple of Jesus, in the preceding paragraph, he had told the story of the unnamed sinful woman who anointed the feet of Jesus. So later in the church tradition, these two women were coalesced, and that's how Mary Magdalene became known in the history of the church as a prostitute, although the texts don't say she was a prostitute.
It was the Gospel of Mary, a book not included in the New Testament, that revealed a fiercely independent Mary Magdalene, a woman who was an apostle and a visionary.
There's a scene in the Gospel of Mary following the ascension of Jesus in which we see the disciples, Peter, Andrew, Levi, and Mary, sitting around chatting. And at one point, Peter probes Mary as to what she has learned from Jesus. He thinks that she and Jesus have had a particularly close relationship and that Jesus may have communicated to Mary some special information that they would like to know.
And Peter is quite ready to say that Mary is the most important of the women around Jesus. So he's quite all right with that. But Mary goes on to divulge special teaching that she got from Jesus and claims to be not first among the women, but specially beloved by Jesus.
The words she speaks to the apostles reflect the unusual mystical teachings of the early Christian Gnostics.
I said to him, "Lord, I saw you today in a vision." He answered and said to me, "Blessed are you that you did not waver at the sight of me, For where the mind is, there is the treasure. I said to him, Lord, now does he who sees the vision see through the soul or through the spirit? The Savior answered and said, he does not see through the soul nor through the spirit, but the mind which is between the two. That is what sees the vision.
Initially, the disciple Andrew exclaims that this teaching that she has communicated to them is very strange. How could Jesus have taught such an unusual thing? But then Peter comes along and he challenges Mary, not based on the information that she has conveyed, but based on her gender. He says something to the effect that how is it that Jesus would have communicated this information to a woman rather than to us? And it's Levi, the disciple Levi, who sort of comes to the defense of Mary of Magdala and says, oh, come on, Peter, you've always been a hothead. Who are we to judge Mary if Jesus himself found her worthy?
If you're imagining why would the Gospel of Mary not be allowed in the canon, there are multiple reasons. One would be probably that its whole attitude towards matter, towards the material universe, is too Gnostic for the tastes of the New Testament. But the other one is what it says about Mary herself. If everything she said was orthodox, if she said the most straightforward, middle-of-the-road approved doctrine, and said that she got it from Jesus, and that she was in charge, it would not get into the New Testament.
Because that women aren't supposed to be intelligent, smart, and forthright, and they're not supposed to follow after a charismatic spiritual leader. And that makes Mary Magdalene very problematic, because if you think about it, who's the first person in the narratives that finds out Jesus is risen? It's Mary Magdalene. It's not any of the guys. It's Mary Magdalene. And so obviously she holds a very high place, but later, when you get to start having all of these theologian types or the other serious guys who come in to try to figure out what's right and what's wrong, you have to sort of call her a name. And a woman who has demons or has a problem or issue, it's easier to call her a demoniac and a prostitute than it is to say she's one of Jesus' beloved.
And all of that seems to reflect what is going on in the church at that time. This is the debate about the role of men and the role of women in the church. Is there room for a figure like Mary? Is there room for an independent female voice in the church? And the Gospel of Mary says, yes, there is. Many of the New Testament texts say, no, there is not.
By the second half of the 4th century, Gnostic texts were censored by the church. Bishop Athanasius sent a letter to be read in every house of worship, every monastery. It was a communication that listed not only the books that were to become the official New Testament, but also those that were to be left out.
And so the Gospel of Mary, like some other Gospels, the Gospel of Peter, were probably Gospels that were only on the fringe. Furthermore, the Gospel of Mary is through and through a Gnostic Gospel and would not have appealed to what I think would be the majority church that determined the shape of the New Testament.
And it seems as if it is very likely that some of the monks near Nag Hammadi heard the pious and powerful and authoritative words of Bishop Athanasius, and they heard him say that there were some books they should not read. And they went to their library, we think, and they cleaned out their library and felt they had to dispose of these books, but they loved these books. They couldn't throw them in the Nile. They couldn't burn them. And so they stuffed them into a big jar, put a top on the jar, and buried the jar safely by a big rock at the foot of a cliff near Nag Hammadi.
And so it was that ancient Gnostic writings would remain hidden, waiting perhaps for another generation and another time to emerge into the light of day. It is a writing that describes Jesus' trial and execution and his descent into hell. It is called the Gospel of Nicodemus.
Prepare to receive Jesus of Nazareth himself, who boasted that he was the Son of God and yet was a man afraid of death, and said, my soul is sorrowful even to death.
It's one of those texts that people have known and have been reading for really quite a long time. It ran into some difficulty with the Protestant reformers, in fact, because it was so popular, that they went out of their way to try to squelch the Gospel of Nicodemus, if you will, and to take it out of circulation.
The first part of the book purports to be an eyewitness account of the Savior's trial and execution. It includes criminal charges made by the high priest of the temple that Jesus is not only a dangerous sorcerer, but also Mary's illegitimate child.
The first part of the book, we can imagine, was written in the 3rd or 4th century because we have testimony to it from church fathers from the 4th century. And it speaks of a people who are concerned about their faith because they're being challenged on the basis of who was this figure who you say died and was resurrected? Was Jesus not the son of a harlot? Was he not the product of fornication? And these sorts of charges that we do know were circulating about Jesus at this time.
It is the second part of Nicodemus that tells the story of Jesus' descent into hell.
And while Satan and the prince of hell were discoursing each other, on a sudden there was a voice as of thunder and the rushing of wind saying, Lift up your gates, O ye princes, and be ye lift up, O everlasting gates, and the King of glory shall come in.
For Nicodemus, the underworld is not the hell we might imagine today, but simply the destination for anyone who dies.
In the descent into hell, he tells not only of Jesus going down into hell and setting free the patriarchs we might expect again, Adam, Isaiah, Abraham, but also of having set free some people who are walking around.
It's not a place of suffering. It's the place where the virtuous dead of the Old Testament, the prophets, somebody like Isaiah, where are they? They're not in hell. They're down there sleeping. So the idea is that Jesus goes down and brings with him all the righteous who have died before him, especially the martyrs. And it's a very beautiful mythological idea. But the resurrection is a sort of a communal event to restore justice where injustice has been practiced.
Some 4th century church leaders believed this gospel was personally written by Nicodemus.
Nicodemus, as a matter of fact, the Greek word, for one who is victorious for the people, was, according to scripture, called a ruler of the Jews, meaning that he occupied a seat in the Supreme Jewish Council called the Sanhedrin. He was certainly a follower of Jesus.
Others claim the Gospel of Nicodemus was a forgery. They believed that well-meaning Christian writers literally created documents meant to gain converts by impressing them with the Savior's power over Satan.
I don't think it intends to deceive anyone, because when it appeared, people would have known where has it been for the last few hundred years. So it's simply a way of telling the story of the Passion of Jesus, adding in all sorts of edifying details.
Even though the book was not included in the Christian canon, it exerted a profound influence on Christianity. Perhaps part of the reason was its telling of Jesus' final journey to the cross.
The fact that Luke does not mention Jesus meeting his mother on the way towards the cross really probably disturbed some of these early communities, and they wanted Mary to be there. So a creative genius within the community, if you consider these writings to be done by a genius, put her in there. And then of course this eventually develops into the Stations of the Cross much later. And that would be an important one on the way to the cross, because of the mention of the holy women.
We know that in the 5th century in Jerusalem, pilgrims stopped at the place where they believed Pilate's trial of Jesus had occurred. And there's some thought that that may in fact be connected to this book, to the Gospel of Nicodemus.
But why was the Gospel of Nicodemus not included in the Holy Bible?
Well, the Gospel of Nicodemus didn't make the cut into the canon for a couple of different reasons. First of all, the second half probably wasn't written prior to the creation of the canon, the descent into hell part. The first half, the story of the trial of Jesus, also doesn't seem to have been discussed that much in the 3rd and 4th century by the sorts of people who were putting together canons. Probably because they saw it as very new, very recent, and therefore not even worthy of serious discussion for inclusion in the canon.
This is another case of a book being written too late. In a sense, you know that this story can't possibly be true. It's a corroboration of all of these other stories that are on the ground at the time. This can't possibly be a story that's written by an eyewitness. So in a sense, this is not a valid resource.
It is also possible that a story of Jesus in the underworld was too speculative or too disturbing for early Christian leaders. But why was this story so important to many early Christians?
This is an important story partially because you have certain parts of the Christian community say there is no hell. Hell doesn't exist. Hell is like the state that you live in.
Perhaps the Gospel of Nicodemus was popular in early Christianity because it suggested that heaven and hell exist here and now on earth.
It is a holy tradition of the church to say that Jesus descended into the pit of despair, into the pit of darkness. Because what is hell? Hell is distance from God. Hell is being outside of the light and the love of God.
Next, an apocalyptic writing that almost became the final chapter in the New Testament.
When the day of God comes, all the children of men from the east unto the west shall be gathered before my Father, whoever lives. And he will command hell to open its bars of steel and to give up all that is in it.
The Apocalypse of Peter was one of many apocalyptic writings popular with early Christians. It was almost included in the Bible, but the Revelation of John was chosen instead. Why was Peter's apocalypse such a hot contender? And why was John's apocalypse, the book of Revelation, chosen instead?
More people felt that John may have actually been written by an early disciple or apostle of Jesus. By the 4th century, most people were convinced that the apocalypse of Peter was not actually the product of Peter's hand. That, and I would also suggest that the Revelation of John is a more finely wrought book. It's simply a better piece of literature, and the Apocalypse of Peter is more of a cobbling together of other people's visions, and it's less original, less finely wrought, and in some sense, less beautiful.
In the first 3 centuries after the execution of Jesus, the Romans were torturing and executing not only Christians and Jews, but all those they believed to be enemies of their empire. It was during these days that tales of the end times, called apocalyptic writings, began to appear.
The word apocalypse is a Greek word that means unveiling or revelation. And an apocalypse is actually an unveiling of heavenly secrets in its theological definition. It's God opening heaven to reveal something.
Apocalyptic writings were suppressed by the authorities because symbolically they presented dangerous ideas, like the defeat of imperial tyrannies such as the Roman Empire.
And the revelation usually is about how soon is the end of the evil age that is all around us, this age of injustice and impurity and violence. It's not about the end of the world, as we use the expression, it's about the end of evil. How long, O Lord, will it go on? God will overcome someday, but how soon?
We often see people writing apocalypses around times of great persecution. This is true of John's revelation in the Bible, as is true for the apocalypse of Peter.
In the second century, many Christians believed the apocalypse of Peter was spiritually inspired. Perhaps this was the reason it was seriously considered for inclusion in the New Testament.
When Eusebius talks about the books that are accepted, disputed, and rejected. In the disputed columns, there was ones that could go in or out, he puts the Apocalypse of Peter and admits it was very, very popular. In fact, he has more doubts about the Apocalypse of John, which is the one in our New Testament we call the Book of Revelation. He's very unsure about that, but the Apocalypse of Peter is really one he seriously considers.
Peter's Apocalypse graphically describes the classes of sinners and their sins, their punishment, and the salvation of the righteous.
It gives a revelation of what hell looks like in gruesome detail. It's like looking at one of those medieval paintings. If you're a blasphemer, you're hung up by your tongue. If you're a fornicator, you are hung up by the appropriate male appendage.
We have people hanging by their hair, fornicators, people who are sexually attractive. We have people, usurers, being punished in their particular way. I believe they're up to their knees in filth, and various other things, blasphemers. And we also have very specific to the Apocalypse of Peter. People who are being punished, who testify against martyrs, who are people who led to the martyrdom of individuals, no doubt, in the community of the author of the Apocalypse of Peter.
Peter's apocalypse suggests there is a way out of punishment for evildoers. Perhaps it was this idea that led to its exclusion from the Holy Canon.
One idea in there, that after hell and heaven are established and there's a perfect world, if those in heaven look down and see hell and the evil ones suffering there, and they ask God for universal redemption to take everyone out of hell, they will get it. Now, this is an extraordinary idea. Peter, in the story, asks Jesus about this. Why are there so many people suffering down here? He's very worried. He can't accept it. He can't be sort of vengeful and say, well, they had it coming to them. So he wants to know, how can this be? You've got a merciful, forgiving God, and these people for all eternity in hell? And Jesus says, well, it's like a secret. I'll tell you the answer, but you can't tell anyone. The answer is, they will all get out. But don't tell anyone, because they just commit more sins. That's a forbidden idea, not just a forbidden book. It's a forbidden idea, because if you were to tell people they could get out of hell, then everyone's going to say, well, you can do whatever you want.
There was a second Apocalypse of Peter, a Gnostic text that contained yet another scenario of the end times. But, being Gnostic, it bore the stamp of heresy, and therefore was forbidden.
He calls bishops and deacons dry canals, and he's trying to stake out authority for the Gnostic movement. But the greatest feature of the Gnostic Apocalypse of Peter is this description of the death of Jesus, in which a human body is being crucified, but the real Christ is standing off to the side, laughing and mocking at this attempt to kill the Son of God, when of course, in Gnostic ideology, the real Son of God never was human.
In fact, many other popular writings, like The Life of Adam and Eve, the Book of Enoch, and the Infancy Gospels, were never seriously considered for inclusion in the Holy Bible. They are but a sampling of the hundreds more that are known today. Perhaps there are still more yet to be found. Possibly another ancient scroll lying undisturbed in a Holy Land cave, a book buried in the hot, dry sands of North Africa, a manuscript lost in a dusty stack of books somewhere in a long-neglected library.
We have to remember that the books that we have outside the New Testament are just random. They happen to survive. There are probably dozens more, hundreds more that are gone forever.
The Gnostic texts are finally coming to the attention of people. They were texts that were hidden away. They were buried in the sands of Egypt. There are Greco-Roman and Jewish and Christian, Islamic, Cathar materials all together in these texts.
I think when we only have the canon to work with, we tend to see early Christianity very, very narrowly. And the reality is, when we go back and we look at just this amazing variety of texts, that we understand that people had various different ways of looking at who Jesus was, what his relationship to God was, what his relationship to the individual believer was. And that, to me, is the tremendous loss of only having a select few books which have traveled through history in the canon.